to these, we already discussed the definition of bulk modulus, right? I'll write it again. This is the bulk modulus.
So is it option A?
Option A. Others? Okay, Purvik is also getting A. Yes, option A is correct here. So volume change by 10%. It means that delta V by V is actually 0.1. Okay, and delta P is also given. Delta P is P2 minus P1. Okay, so that is 1.6564, in fact. 1.64 into 10 raised to the power 4 pascals. Right? 1.55. All right, so bulk modulus will be delta P divided by delta V by V. So it will be 1.55 into 10 raised to the power 5. Okay, that's why option A is correct. What about the 11th one? So here comes the surface tension concept. Resistant. This is hemisphere. This is subhemisphere. Fine. So, can I say that radius of bubble 1 is less than radius of bubble 2? Yes or no? I can see there is a debate going on. So, I'll just show you something over here. Let's say this is the, you know, diameter of the pipe. Okay, now let me draw a circle over here. Now here I am drawing a circle whose diameter is equal to the length of the pipe itself, or the length or the diameter of the pipe itself. Now let me draw a sub hemispherical shape here. So this line no longer be a diameter. Are you getting it? So this is how the scenario will be. Okay, so you can see that, I mean, I'm not able to perfectly draw this, it will be like that. Okay, so you can see that the white circle, okay, where you can just consider scenario like this. Now tell me, which one has bigger radius, the white or the orange one? This is, let us say, hemispherical, which is R1 radius. This is subhemispherical, which is R2. Which has more radius? The white one, right? So that is the reason why a subhemispherical bubble will have larger radius. Okay. Now, we know that delta P for a bubble is 4S by R. Okay. Delta P is what? Delta P is pressure inside minus pressure outside. Outside pressure is atmospheric pressure. Okay. This should be equal to 4S by R1. Right. Right now, my focus is to find P1. So I'll write it as P1 minus PA is 4S by R1. Are you able to see my screen? Okay. So this is, let us say, my first equation. And my second equation is P2 minus PA is 4S by R2. Okay. Now tell me which is more, P2 or P1? Since R1 is less than R2, okay, so P1 minus P2, or P1 minus PA, sorry, this will be more than P2 minus PA, right? Hence, P1 is greater than P2. Getting it? So, pressure here is more than pressure there. And that is the reason why the air will flow like this. So air will go from 1 to 2, from higher pressure to lower pressure. That's its regular tendency. Right? And when it does that, then the pressure of 1 reduces, pressure of 2 increases. Okay? So air flows from 1 to 2 and the volume of soap bubble at end one decreases. So that is why option B is correct over here. Any doubt, guys, on this question? I'll move to next one. Meanwhile, any doubts? Okay, do these two questions. Okay, anyone? Question 12. Mishra is saying, no, Mr. answering 13th one. Okay. Yes, 13th is C. So 12th one is clearly a question which will just eat up a lot of your time. Okay. So the smart way is to first answer question number 13 and then go to question number 12. So we'll also be smart and we'll answer question number 13 first. One end of the horizontal thick copper wire of length 2L and radius 2R is welded to an end of another horizontal thin copper wire, length L and radius R. When the arrangement is stretched by applying forces at two ends, the ratio of elongation in the thin wire to that of thick wire is what is asked. So the thick copper wire has length 2L and radius 2R. The thin one has length L and radius R. Now they are pulled by some force. Let us say force is F. Okay. So if you draw a free body diagram of the thicker wire, it will experience same force, and the thin wire also experience the same force. Okay, so we have the stress in the thick wire equal to be force divided by pi into 2R square. Okay, so this is F divided by 4 times pi R square, fine. And sigma of the thin wire is F divided by pi R square. All right. And we know that stress by strain is constant. So let's say thick is sigma 1 and thin is sigma 2. So sigma 1 by epsilon 1, it's Young's modulus, right? Should be equal to sigma 2 by epsilon 2. So from here, I will get epsilon 1 divided by epsilon 2 to be equal to sigma 1 by sigma 2, right? Sigma 1 by sigma 2 is 1 by 4, okay? Epsilon 1 is delta L 1 divided by the length of the thicker wire, which is 2L, divided by delta L 2 divided by L. This is equal to 1 by 4. Okay, so from here, I will get delta L 1 by delta L 2 to be equal to 1 by 2. Okay. So delta elongation in the thin wire is 2 times the elongation in the thick wire. So don't be in a hurry and you should not mark B. Okay, option C you should mark, because to clearly see which one you are finding the ratio of. All right. Now let us try to solve question number 12. Question number 12 is actually one of those questions which distinguish toppers from others. Okay, so it's not a straightforward one. There are a lot of fine things which people ignore. Okay, so anyways, a thin uniform cylindrical shell closed at both the ends. So you have a cylindrical shell which is closed from both the end, is partially filled with water. So this cylinder is filled with water. Okay, it is floating vertically in the water, half submerged state. So it is half submerged. Fine. And if rho c is the relative density of the material of the shell, rho c with respect to water, then correct statement is that shell is more than half filled. Okay, so basically, you know, we should first, before even thinking, first we should do the force balance here, okay, and then look at the statements, because we need to actually evaluate if what happens, then what will happen. So if then else statements are the options are in terms of if then else statements, right? So we need to first get some equations, then only we can assess the statements. So if you do force balance, then there is downward force. Okay, so there is this downward force, let us say mg. Okay, and then there will be a buoyant force. Okay, so simply buoyant force has to be equal to mg. Buoyant force should be equal to m into g. Now mg can be divided into two parts, mg of the shell, this is shell, okay, plus mg of the water. This should be equal to the buoyant force. Okay, now buoyant force is what? Buoyant force is the weight of the liquid that is displaced. Okay, so if, let us say, if this is the total height is h, then about h by 2 height we have the cylinder occupied, because it is written that in half submerged state it is floating. Okay, so if area of cross section is A, okay, then I can say that buoyant forces A into H by 2 into rho of water into G. Okay, so this is for the cylinder, and also there will be some amount of liquid that is displaced because of the thickness of the cylinder, you know. So if, let us say, the entire volume of the shell, okay, is V, if you ignore the thickness of the shell, then because of the thickness of the shell, you can ignore the volume displaced, okay. But if you say here, if you look from the top, if the cylinder is like this, it has some thickness, okay. If it has some thickness, then area of cross section is this inner area, okay. Why I'm distinguishing two areas? Because the relative densities are different, okay. So this plus the area, the volume which is displaced, let's say V by 2, where V is the volume of the shell, okay. This volume of the shell divided by 2 into density of water into G, okay. This is the total buoyant force. This is because of the cylindrical hole, and this is because of the thickness of the cylinder. This is the weight of the liquid that is displaced. Now, this will be equal to the weight of the shell, which is volume the shell divided by, you have to take total volume the shell, volume the shell into density of the shell into G, okay, plus you have mg of the water inside. So let us say up to X level the water is inside, okay. So I can say that area into x is the volume of the water inside into density of water into G, okay. So let me tell you that this question may not have been solved by the toppers also. They might have also left it, okay. So this is meant to learn the concept, but not to actually, you know, solve. So I mean, this is a good opportunity for you to understand how the concepts are applied. Okay, Purvik is asking me to explain again. See, when the cylinder is submerged inside the water, okay, it will displace the volume of the water, okay. Now, what I'm doing is, I'm treating the cylinder as if it is hollow, but it has some finite thickness. Okay, so area of cross section is the area of the whole of the cylinder. Okay, so I am treating that the hollow cylindrical part separately here, because I have to use the density of the material over here. Okay, so the volume of the water that is displaced because the cylinder is going down is equal to the volume of the hollow portion of the cylinder plus the volume of the material which is inside the water. Getting it? So that is the reason why we have, let us say, volume of the shell to be equal to Vs, which is the actual volume of the material. Then V shell divided by 2 into rho W into G. This is the volume or weight of the water that is displaced, which is the volume which corresponds to the volume of the material only. Okay, but then not only that much volume is displaced, but also the volume corresponding to that hollow portion is also displaced. I hope I am making sense here. Let me, Purit, are you able to understand this? Or should I explain again? See, this is the scenario. What I'm saying is that this cylindrical thing has some thickness. Okay, so let us say this is the thickness of the cylinder. So if I just consider this thickness itself, it will have some volume. Yes or no? Just this thickness or the volume of the material that is used to build a cylinder, if I just consider that, it has some volume. So that volume, the material used in the cylinder is Vs. Fine. But that volume will just give you the volume of the material used. But when this cylinder is inside the water, it will not only displace the volume corresponding to the material, but it will displace the entire volume from here till there. Getting it? So the volume the water displaced, how I'm finding? I'm first finding the volume which is corresponding to this, and then I'm finding volume which is corresponding to the material which is there. I am separating them apart because the density of the material is given separately and the conditions or the options are given with respect to that. So that is the reason why we are doing it. And it is okay, Purvik, that you're not able to do it right in the first go. So it is expected. So, but then you should understand how it is doing. It is done right now. That is more important. Okay, so you will get an equation. You'll get an equation corresponding to X now. Okay, so once you get an equation corresponding to X, all you have to do now is to evaluate those options. Okay, so now here onwards, try to now analyze the situation further and get back to me in case you have any further doubts, because again, it will take more than 15-20 minutes of discussion just on this question itself. So try this out at your end and let me know if you get stuck. Okay. So I'll move to the next one.